In the pursuit of studying our oceans, Hakai's oceanographers employ all sorts of instruments to study the physical, chemical, and biological properties of water up and down the West Coast. But to venture across the continental shelf and into the open waters of the Northeast Pacific, we are going beyond the tethers and employing ocean gliders that are basically...
They're autonomous robots. So we put them into the ocean and then we pilot them from any location that you want as long as you have an internet connection.
Glider specialists have gathered here at the Calvert Island Ecological Observatory on the central coast of British Columbia to deploy three gliders on a mission to survey oceanographic conditions part of the way across the continental shelf.
I think the really amazing thing about gliders is their ability to replace ship time. If you go out on a ship and you want to take profiles across the ocean, you're talking many, many man hours, a lot of fuel, a lot of time on an expensive vessel. If you have a glider out, it can do that same mission in a matter of months and collect even better data.
This mission, hopefully the first of many, will test whether these gliders can survive everything the ocean can throw at them out on the shelf. But first, the gliders have an ocean journey to make before they ever touch water. All three gliders arrive safe and sound on Calvert Island via barge. To get these gliders out to sea requires a collaborative effort with partners at the Hakai Institute, Fisheries and Oceans Canada, the University of Victoria, and the University of British Columbia, all working together under one banner called SeaProof, the Canadian Pacific Robotic Ocean Observing Facility. Soon after the gliders make their debut, the SeaProof oceanographers and technicians arrive and start prepping.
We personify them to a high degree. They all have names. The one out in the water right now is Mike, which is short for Mike Row Rider. And the one beside us right here is Rosie, named after Rosie from the Jetsons.
And then, of course, there's Eva, a name taken from one of the robots in the movie WALL-E. But make no mistake, these gliders have serious work to do.
So on this mission, our gliders are measuring salt, heat, oxygen in the water, mixing. Down the road, as we get new sensors, we could go out and use acoustics to look at zooplankton in the water. We could, once they're fully tested and developed, even have a sensor that looks at ocean acidification as it's happening.
And it also has a few optical sensors for looking at primary productivity, so we can look at chlorophyll fluorescence, so that tells us something about what the standing stock of phytoplankton is.
And the types of sensors that we can use on gliders are increasing all the time.
Calvert Island sits on the eastern end of an underwater canyon that's in size all the way out to the continental slope. And so that canyon is a conduit for deep ocean water to get into Queen Charlotte Sound. And we can see that happening very clearly. We can see this dense, cold, low oxygen water coming up, so it's in that canyon.
That's important because if you get enough upwelling winds, it's going to mix that low oxygen but high nutrient water up into the water column. And the impact of this research extends beyond the central coast.
We rely heavily in stuff that has nothing to do with oceans on good seasonal predictions of what's going to happen to the weather on timescales of months. It's really nice to have those seasonal predictions to know whether it's going to be a bad ski season this year, whether it is going to be a good crop season for wheat. Having better observations of what's happening in the ocean allows those predictions to be better.
Before deployment, gliders need a final pre-dive check from the team, which includes running simulations to see that they can dive properly.
Well, they're called gliders, and they work a lot like hang gliders. So with a hang glider, you would always be going down because you would be heavy relative to the air. But they can actually go both ways because when they get to the bottom, they actually change their buoyancy.
The gliders change their buoyancy by pumping a small amount of oil into or out of the nose of the glider. That tiny little bit of oil is enough to change its density.
If you were to crack open the glider here, you would see a whole bunch of circuit boards. It has lots of smarts inside it. It is basically a robot. it has two main computers and a whole bunch of subboards. And so one of the computers is focused on collecting scientific data, and the other one's all focused on its mission. You know, even a tiny little hair in one of these O-rings could make the water leak in, and then the whole thing will sink.
The glider named Mike quickly gets its namesake, the Micro Rider, fitted to it. Despite its tough missile appearance, the Micro Rider is easily the most delicate piece of equipment on board.
So the Micro Rider measures small-scale turbulence in the ocean, and the way we do that is actually quite ingenious, but also simpler than you'd think. It's basically a phonograph needle from a record player, and then they've encased it in a little airfoil. And then what happens is, as it moves through the water, the turbulence hits it, flex it, so it's just like it's riding in a record player. It just makes a different signal that goes back to our, instead of our loudspeakers, it goes back to our sensors and records that. And then we turn the strengths of those oscillations into estimates of how much turbulence there was.
Should the Micro Rider survive deployment and the rough seas following, they will have the first turbulence data ever collected in this area. And finally, one by one, the deployments commence, starting with Mike. Can you
confirm? We're extremely nervous when we deploy these instruments. They go down to 1,000 meters, which means basically 100 atmospheres of pressure, and they're in a corrosive, salty environment. So those two things are our biggest enemy when we're doing any type of oceanography.
It doesn't help that Queen Charlotte Sound is notoriously rough. The crew and camera team battle seasickness as Mike is carefully lowered off the side.
When the glider's out at sea, I think the first thing we're looking at is the glider diving the way we expect it to? So when a glider dives, it follows a sawtooth pattern up and down through the water, making Vs. If the glider is in any difficulty, the shape of those Vs will change. So you might have a glider that developed a leak and becomes heavier than it was when you put it in the water. If that happens, that shape of the dive will change to reflect that it's having trouble climbing to the surface because it's heavy now. That would be considered like an emergency situation, and we would go out in a boat and bring the glider back home.
With Mike successfully deployed, Rosie and Eva soon follow.
When you're going out to sea and you're out on the open ocean, it can be quite rough out there and quite swelly, and you're having to deal just kind of with the elements. And so you're on a rocking boat, trying not to bump your instrument too much. So often we have to troubleshoot when they are out there and to adjust parameters like their pitch going down and their speed going down to make sure that they have the optimal angle for flying, both to maximize their battery and also just to maximize speed and to get the right data. And then once they're out there, any number of things could go wrong. And so we've done our best to check them out beforehand. So Eva is a different glider than the Slocum gliders. And so she's got a bit of a different design. She's got this long antenna at the back. So when she comes up to the surface, she comes and she kind of sticks her tail out of the water, and her antenna comes out of the water and transmits the data back to us. And that's also our way of communicating with her.
Communications are actually one of the most challenging aspects of working with the gliders. They can go offline without warning, making any hope for retrieval extremely low.
So it's relatively high risk. You know, a lot of the oceanography that I've done in the past, you at least have something that's attached by a cable to the ship. And if something's attached by a cable and it breaks, you pull it up and see what happened. The scary thing about gliders is they will just disappear.
It is quite exciting. You kind of feel like you are a real ocean pilot, but you're doing it from shore, and so it's kind of the best of both worlds.
After only a few days at sea, the gliders are communicating invaluable data.
So the glider that I work closely with, who is named Mike, has already been deployed, and he's been out for a couple days now. And we're already getting data back and seeing some very interesting signals. So Mike basically went straight offshore and diving into progressively deeper water. And as he got out, he started to see the signal of upwelling. And what we're seeing is that this year's upwelled water is extremely low in oxygen.
We call it hypoxic waters, and not many animals can live in those waters. And if those waters are brought up onto the shelf near Calvert Island, then we may expect that they will harm a lot of the animals that live here.
A few weeks later, and despite some tense moments of radio silence, all three gliders are successfully retrieved. A successful test run for the big plans that follow. Seaproof hopes to eventually support 13 gliders cruising through the deepest canyons on the Central Coast for months at a time, and extending surveys off the continental shelf to the deep ocean.
So this week, this glider mission has been a long time coming, and we had some technical difficulties with the gliders, but we have all come together, we've overcome them, and we are already getting amazing data that really has made all of the time and the effort worthwhile.
We don't know what these gliders are going to tell us. Like, the most exciting parts are yet to come as we're getting the data back.
Long term, we'd like to be permanently doing this line down the trough off of Calvert Island. We'd like to be permanently doing three lines offshore of both Haida Gwaii and Vancouver Island, and have those occupied full time. That's going to take effort to get there, but we're confident that we can do that.
These gliders are really an important piece of getting a big picture idea of what's going on in our oceans, and that's going to be really important moving forward.